Are you a scientific pantheist? When you look at the night sky, or images of the Hubble Space Telescope, are you filled with feelings of awe and wonder at the overwhelming beauty and power of the universe? When you are in the midst of nature, in a forest, by the sea, on a mountain peak, do you ever feel a sense of the sacred, like the feeling of being in a vast cathedral? Do you believe that humans should be a part of nature, rather than set above it? Do you see the power of science and the scientific process to help explain nature and the cosmos, but you are skeptical about a God who is separate from, who is other than nature and the wider universe? Yet you feel an emotional need for a recognition of something greater than your own self and the human race? If yes, scientific pantheism is very probably your natural religious home. Pantheism is older than Buddhism or Christianity, and may already count hundreds of millions among its members. Most Taoists are pantheists, along with many Chinese, Japanese, and Western Buddhists. Deep ecologists, pagans, animists, followers of many native religions, and many Unitarian Universalists. The central philosophical scriptures of Hinduism are pantheistic. Many atheists and humanists may be naturalistic pantheists without realizing it. Scientific or natural pantheism is a modern form of pantheism that deeply reveres the universe and nature and joyfully accepts and embraces life, the body, and earth, but does not believe in any supernatural deities, entities, or powers. At the heart of pantheism is the reverence of the universe in and of itself as the ultimate focus of reverence, and for the natural earth as sacred. Scientific or natural pantheism, Pan for short, has a naturalistic approach which simply accepts and reveres the universe and nature just as they are, and promotes an ethic of respect for human and animal rights and for lifestyles that sustain rather than destroy the environment. When scientific pantheists say, "We revere the universe," we are not talking about a supernatural being. We are talking about the way our senses and our emotions force us to respond to the overwhelming mystery and power that surrounds us. We are part of the universe. Our Earth was created from the universe and will one day be reabsorbed into the universe. We are made of the same matter and energy as the universe. We are not in exile here. We are at home. It is only here that we will ever get the chance to see paradise face to face. If we believe our real home is not here, but in a land that lies beyond death, if we believe that the numinous is found only in old books or old buildings or inside our head, outside this reality, then we will see this real, vibrant, luminous world as if through a glass darkly. The universe creates us, preserves us, and destroys us. It is deep and old beyond our ability to reach with our senses. It is beautiful beyond our ability to describe in words. It is complex beyond our ability to fully grasp in science. We must relate to the universe with humility, awe, reverence, celebration, and the search for deeper understanding. In many other ways that believers relate to their God, minus the worship, the groveling, and the expectation that there is some being out there, a personal God who can answer our prayers. This overwhelming presence is everywhere, inside you and outside you. You can never be separated from it. Whatever else is taken from you, this can never be taken from you. Wherever you are, it's there with you. Wherever you go, it goes with you. Whatever happens to you, it remains with you. You are indeed one with the cosmos. When pantheists say we revere and care for nature, we mean it with just as much commitment and reverence as believers in speaking about their church or mosque or the relics of their saints. But again, we are not talking about supernatural beings. What we are saying is that we are a part of nature, that nature made us, and at our death we will be reabsorbed into nature. We are at home in nature and in our bodies. This is where we belong. This is the only place where we can find and make our paradise, not in some imaginary world on the other side of the grave. If nature is the only paradise, then separation from nature is the only hell. When we destroy nature, we create hell on earth for other species and for ourselves. Nature is our mother, our home, our security, our peace, our past, and our future. We should treat natural things and habitats as believers treat their temples and shrines, as sacred, to be revered and preserved in all their intricate and fragile beauty. Pantheism adopts a positive approach to life on Earth. It offers the most positive and embracing approach to life, the body, and nature of any philosophy or religion. Our bodies are not base and evil, they are good. Nature is not a reflection of something higher, it is in and of itself the highest. Nature and life is not a path to somewhere else, it is the destination. We must make the best of it while we have it. Scientific pantheism is rooted in the present world. It reconciles concern for humans and concern for the planet. It places life, not death, as the focus of our concern. The central motto of scientific pantheism is a healthy mind, a healthy body, and a healthy earth. Pantheism fosters a mind that accepts the world, a mind alert to vibrant reality, in touch with the senses, receptive to the energy of the body and the universe, a mind fully awake to nature, open to new knowledge, and responsive to the beauty of the natural world. Pantheism fosters a mind that accepts life, the body, and the self, a mind that is free from guilt about original sin or its inability to be a martyr, free of anxiety about death or the possibility of eternal punishment beyond death. Pantheism fosters a sane and whole mind that respects reason and evidence, that will not accept key beliefs without rational basis, simply on the claims of ancient scriptures or the assertion of gurus. Pantheism demands no faith in impossible events and secret revelations. Pantheism satisfies our need to revere something greater than ourselves, yet it never turns its back on the earth and never departs from the evidence before us. Pantheism fuses spirituality and science, mind and body, humans and nature. Transcendental religions, especially primitive Christianity, Theravada Buddhism, have a negative attitude to the body. The body is seen as a temporary container for the soul, or as a disgusting bag of foul substances. Pantheism has a totally positive attitude. The body is natural and is sacred like every other part of nature. Its pleasures are good and not evil, as long as they are pursued without harm to one's health, to other humans, or to nature. Looking after the body, preserving its health and fitness through a healthy diet and exercise are things we can and should do without slinking feelings of guilt. For transcendental religions, the whole earth, like the body, is merely a temporary stage which will be destroyed before the last judgment, or it will vanish when we realize it is mere illusion. But this earth is not a staging post and it is not an illusion. Pantheism affirms the earth and upholds nature as the most sacred temples. Concern for the health of the earth is not just a matter of human survival, not just a matter of preserving diversity and wilderness for our enjoyment. It is a primary spiritual and ethical duty. A spiritual approach should be in keeping with the age of science and the environment. At the beginning of the third millennia, we have become citizens of the cosmos. Through the eyes of telescopes, we have seen the universe as never before. We have seen the emptiness of space, strewn with galaxies as thick as snow. We have seen the birth of stars. We have found planetary disks around many stars. We have found amino acids in space. In this situation, with our growing knowledge, it is becoming impossible to believe in personal gods who are separate and other than, apart from, the universe itself, or gods who created this ungraspable immensity simply as a frame for our tiny presence. During the same generation, we have lost our citizenship of this earth and risk losing our delicate foothold in the cosmos. We have acquired the power to modify life, to alter ecosystems, and to change the planet itself and threaten the future of every species, including our own. Today, we need a spiritual approach that provides powerful backing for environmental action. Yet the three largest Western religions provide only feeble support. In this generation, spirituality must come of age and be reborn into the age of space, the age of science, and the age of the environment. As Carl Sagan wrote in The Pale Blue Dot in 1994, a religion, old or new, that stressed the magnificence of the universe as revealed by modern science might be able to draw forth reserves of reverence and awe hardly tapped by the conventional faiths. Sooner or later, such a religion will emerge. And my message to you is that scientific pantheism is that religion.